babies are torn apart, like this is my tax money funding.
I want to see what you agree with all us. All of us.
And yes, I want to oppose my morality.
This side, yes.
Yeah. I was just wondering how abortion is like a whole thing. That's what I'm trying to wonder, but like everyone's just screaming. I can't go.
Yeah. 56 million babies have been aborted by abortion since 1973, which was more than the Jewish Holocaust.
Are you just comparing it as a death toll or from a morality standpoint
too? You know, Hitler thought that the Jewish population, and not just the Jews, yeah, but there were other people as well, that they were less than human, that they should be considered devalued by society because in Hitler's mind they weren't the perfect race. So he deemed them, he dehumanized them, basically. And there were people that went along with it, you know, hundreds of thousands of people that were in agreement with him. They were brainwashed into thinking that it was okay. And today, we've devalued the human being. So, do I have permission to videotape you?
Oh, but you don't care about permission.
So he's okay with me.
Okay, but my friends are behind him.
Okay, so anyways, these children have been dehumanized because of their size. They've been devalued because of their level of development or their environment, but none of those things changes the value of a person.
I don't agree with saying an abortion is the same as the Holocaust.
It's actually worse. It's worse.
Well, I think the people in the Holocaust did not have a choice. Where people who have abortions, they do have a choice.
But the victims don't have a choice.
They have a choice to survive outside the
Of course, the Nazis had the choice to either do their job, as they would say, and taking the lives of, you know, hundreds of thousands of innocent people, but the mother has the choice to take the life of her child. You know, it was wrong back then, and it's wrong today.
Teenage, my arm is getting tired, and I've already got footage, but I've enjoyed this opportunity.
That's the issue. Well, I personally do not agree with Planned Parenthood. I don't agree with saying no to abortions in general.
So in which case would you believe it's justified to do this to a child?
In the case that it's not born yet. I disagree that this is better than the alternative of it growing up in a life where it has to live, suffer through more years and suffer at once. You know what I mean?
So, have you had any suffering in your life?
Not much, but I didn't come from a situation where an abortion might have been necessary. You know what I mean?
Like, right, but
I wasn't neglected as a child. I wasn't put through adoption. I can't say, you know what I mean? Like,
well, I know lots of people who have suffered horrendous things in their lives. My two best friends were both brutally raped. And, you know, they don't close their eyes when walking out in front of traffic. They still value their lives. They eat three meals a day. They get plenty of rest at night because they still value their life. And, you know, of course, they had wished they hadn't had to endure that, but they're better people today because of that suffering. And not that they wish to go through it again, but I have a friend named Anna Ritchie, and she was raped by her stepfather at age 11. And he forced her to have an abortion. She got pregnant again by his sexual abuse at age 12, and she cried out to her mother, told her mother what was happening. She had that baby, she delivered, and that's her greatest joy in life. She's so grateful to God that he spared that child and their best friends, you know, and to her, out of that, she said she would have gone through all of that, endured all of that again for her child. She would do anything for her child.
That's where it's my personal standpoint comes from, the fact that I can't have a child. I don't have a child. I can't have a child inside of me, like a woman. I can't give birth to a child, but I don't believe that I can say what a woman should do. You know what I mean?
Well,
like,
okay.
I can't take away, I don't want to take away a woman's choice whether to or to not have an abortion. You know what I'm, like, I'm trying to say?
Well, let's say you were walking in a park, okay, and you came across a scene where a man was violently raping a woman. Would you go over and intervene in that situation?
Honestly.
Or would you just mind your own business and keep on walking?
I can't say.
Would you at least call 911?
I would try. I'm not saying I wouldn't try if it was my choice. If it was my child,
I'm just talking about a man is raping a woman and you walk by. Are you going to intervene?
I would call the cops.
Okay, so that's an intervention. Okay? Now, he may say, he may use the argument, I can do with my body whatever I want. Well, there's a limit to that, because now it's violating the rights of another. And in the same way, abortion violates the rights of another human being, because this isn't a woman's body. You know, this is a baby's body. No, this is a baby's body. You know, so when we say things like, oh, I'm pro-choice, what choice are you for? Your choice is dismembering, disemboweling, decapitating a human life, an innocent human life. You know, a child that's not able to struggle and get away from his attacker, like a woman who's being raped. At least she can fight. But this child can't even fight to get away. So who's protecting this child? And by saying that, you know, it sounds like you're trying to take the more neutral path. Like, okay, well, I'm not gonna be opposed to it, and I'm not really for it. I'm just gonna stay somewhere in the middle. But by not opposing it, you're allowing evil to triumph. There's a great quote that says, "The only thing necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing." You know, and what's happening here is the most unjust thing I can personally think of. A baby, a human baby, a little baby that should be loved and given care by its mother. Okay, this should be like common sense, you know, a mother caring for her child. This should be a normal reaction when a woman finds out she's pregnant, that she should rejoice for the gift that God has granted her. You know, but when we don't actively oppose these evils, it strengthens the oppressor and it continues the suffering of the innocent party, the victim. So by you doing nothing on behalf of the child, you're prolonging his suffering. You know, like I said, 56 million, that's a hard number to conceive, but that's a whole generation. I mean, there's 1 out of 3 African-American women will choose to abort their baby once finding out they're pregnant. That's 30%. That's astronomical numbers. You know, let's love our neighbors as ourselves. You know, if we see harm and injustice coming to someone, anyone, even people that we deem less valuable to society's standards, let's love them. You know, let's keep them from harm, not allow people to hurt them.
Personally, I think abortion should be more of a last-minute issue, to the point where you know you cannot fully sustain this child. There are alternatives to letting the child live. I don't agree with Planned Parenthood being funded by the government. I think we should be able to defund it. But we should have other options for women in general, for the other things that Planned Parenthood does. You know what I mean?
There are. There's actually 3 times as many crisis pregnancy centers as there are abortion clinics. More than that, even.
Yeah.
But locally here, we have a crisis pregnancy center within, I would say, a mile
I'm talking about like the other things that not only relate to children. You know what I mean? Like, we should fund hospitals to help out with women issues. Not just women, just people in general. I sort of believe somewhat in socialized medicine, not totally for it. I think you should pay your own. But the government, if you're willing to pay taxes for it, the government's willing to offer it, that should be done. But it's hard to say.
Yeah.
Well, I don't agree on forcing anyone's views on another person. That's my opinion.
Right, but what we're doing in saying that is you're forcing your view upon this child. Because you're not protecting this child, so you're allowing this to happen to this child. So, you know, when people say, I'm pro-choice, my body, my choice, they're forcing their view on this baby.
Well, we force our own views and problems on other people too, though.
But this is a matter of life and death for this child. And like I said, this child has no ability to speak up for himself. So adults have to come along and speak up on behalf of these children. As a Christian, you know, the Bible tells me to rescue those that are being led away to slaughter, to be a voice for the voiceless, a defender of the weak, to love my neighbor as myself. If I wouldn't want this to happen to me, then I should defend to the death this happening to this child.
Do your views come mainly from a Christian aspect? Or
I have a Christian worldview, yeah.
Okay, I was just wondering.
Yeah, yeah, the sixth commandment is thou shalt not murder. And when I see this, I know for sure that that's murder. There's no doubt in my mind that that is murder. You know, this child has, like I said, no ability to defend himself. He was brutally dismembered with blunt instruments. You know, it's murder. So,
what is the worst thing that you think will happen if we continue on this path of allowing abortion?
Well, I think we'll ultimately be destroyed. I look at history and several great empires that basically self-destructed or were destroyed by God. And I fear his judgment. His judgment will come to the just and the unjust alike. It says he reigns on the just and the unjust.
So yeah. Just God or no other issues are involved with bringing down these empires?
Well, he can use anything. I mean, it can be an economic collapse.
I'm not saying, like, do you think morality is all that's important? So if God views something as immoral, he's just going to destroy empires?
Well, this is an abomination to God. This isn't a casual sin.
I can see how you...
The Bible says there are 6 things the Lord hates, 7 that are an abomination to him, lying lips, proud look, and hands that shed innocent blood. All throughout history, we've sacrificed our children. Most of the times, in biblical history, people would sacrifice their children for false gods and idols and things like that. Today, we sacrifice our children on the altar of convenience. It's not convenient. It interferes with a mother's future. They've made themselves a god, and they said that the only thing that matters is me. I'm most important. And so if anything interferes with that, it needs to be taken out. It needs to be destroyed.
Do you ever fear that without abortion being legal, that it would go through like illegal methods to get abortions? People would take alternative routes?
Well, it was just like if we legalized rape, there would be a lot more rape. Okay, if we legalize rape. But because we've passed a law saying that rape is wrong, there's now consequences to raping a woman. There's still people that are out there raping people, right? But it's less frequent because it's not illegal. Or it's not legal. So just because there's an evil that exists, I do think we should make it illegal. If there's, God, anytime God has put his law, like, for instance, God says, thou shalt not steal. Okay, we have laws in place for theft, and they're good laws. They support what God says in his word. I'm in total agreement with laws like that. Thou shalt not murder. We have laws in this country that say if you murder, there's a consequence. You could receive the death penalty. Okay, so when there's consequences, you have people less likely to commit those crimes against humanity. It's the same thing with abortion. Abortion went up exponentially when it was legalized in 1973. Sure, women still did it, and they could find ways to do it. Women will always sacrifice their children, but it will be a lot less likely that they would do that. They're more likely to find, go through adoption or do other means to allow someone else to raise their child if they feel like they can't, maintain the responsibility of rearing a child.
So, now, obviously another big issue with this is sexual education. How do you think we should teach sex in school? How would you like your children to
be? Well, honestly, the whole school system to me is...
I can agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, I would personally homeschool my children and teach them from God's word. I would say sex is something that was given to us by God. It's a beautiful thing, but it's made for the boundary of marriage in order to protect us. Like, I was sexually promiscuous for many, many years, and I called myself a Christian, and I was a big hypocrite. My dad was a pastor, and I would fornicate, and, I was an adulterer at heart, the Bible says. And the Bible says adulterers will not inherit the kingdom of God. So education, in a sense, is good, but the fact is, like, when I go to the abortion clinic on Saturday, I tell moms, I educate them on adoption, I educate them on the crisis pregnancy centers, I educate them on what God's word says about abortion, but many of them still want to kill their babies because the problem is their heart. You know, you've heard the saying, the heart of the problem is the problem of the heart. We can make abortion illegal, but first we have to change the hearts and the minds of the people. Before we pass any laws, we need to change the hearts of the people, and only God can do that through his word. That's why this is a gospel issue. So as far as education, sure, there's a level of that's what we're doing here today. We're educating the public. This is what abortion is. This is why it's wrong.
Well, I don't mean as abortion. I mean as sex.
Just in general. Okay.
Yeah. In general,
yeah.
Like.
Well, I think there's an age where we can definitely educate, children on sex, but with the emphasis being that that sex is permitted in the boundary of marriage, that God created it. It's a beautiful thing, but it's for marriage.
So you agree with teaching abstinence?
Yes.
Would you agree with not, well, if someone doesn't agree with, let's say, Christianity, should you still teach them a Christian view? You know they're not going to accept that view, though.
Right, but, I mean, we all have written on our hearts God's law, whether we choose to believe in it or not. Like, for instance, universally, everyone knows it's wrong to murder. How do we know that? Why do we know that? Because God has written his law upon our hearts. So whether they believe in God or not, his law remains on their hearts, so they know it's wrong to murder. You know, they know it's wrong to lie. They know it's wrong to steal. They know it's wrong to dishonor their parents. God's Ten Commandments.
There are some tribes in Africa where pride comes from murdering other people. So you can't say all people have this thing written into them or they're not getting the message.
We still do things contrary to our conscience.
Every single sin I did, so.
Right, right.
Even if I repented for most of my sins, I could have forgot something and that's imperfect.
Right.
I'm no Jesus Christ. I cannot match up to him.
Well, the truth is we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, every single one of us. We've all lied. That makes us liars. We've all stole. That makes us thieves. We've all committed adultery in our hearts, if not in, you know, in the flesh as well. We've all dishonored our parents at some time. We've all violated God's law. So, you know, guilty people deserve a punishment. And we're guilty of violating God's law. So if we're guilty, deserving of a punishment, that punishment is hell. So technically, we all deserve hell. All of us. And God would be just in sending us all to hell. But because he's a loving, merciful, gracious God, he did something very special so that we wouldn't have to receive what we deserve. He sent his son to take our place. He knew he would have to make the ultimate sacrifice to appease the wrath of God, to settle the debt.
Do you believe in like the idea of Dante's Inferno, that there's different levels of hell?
Well, I believe there.
In the scripture,
well, it does talk about like, I think there's different levels of punishment. Okay, if there's, like, for instance, if
you
know,
are you saying like sins are on different levels too?
Yes, like murder is an abomination. You know, the hands of shedness was an abomination to God.
For me that, like, do you think murder is on the same level as lying?
Well, you know, God says he hates a lying tongue, you know. So God does emphasize some sins. Like he says, blasphemy is the unforgivable sin. So that sin is worse than all other sins because it's unforgivable. It's unforgivable. And blasphemy, basically what that is denying Christ until your dying breath.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just the sin of taking the Lord's name in vain.
What about people who never heard the voice of God?
Like people in Africa or...
Well, people even before.
Okay. Well, I believe if the Bible says if you seek God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, I believe he will reveal himself to them. You know, we can look around, like I said, if I had never heard a day in my life about Christ or about God, but just common sense tells me that this tree had to come from somewhere. And I can't create a tree from nothing.
Well, just wondering, what if you don't believe in God, but let's say you believe in Allah. You are looking up to a God. You're living by the standards that you believe that God imposed. If you lived a just life and you repented, even though it was to a different God,
right,
but you've never heard of the real God,
what
would happen to them?
God, they would be sentenced to hell because they violated his laws.
They've never heard of him, and what if they saw that God is real, but they've only viewed it as their God because they know no other God?
Well, if they're seeking God with all their heart, I truly believe he would reveal himself to them in the true form, in the right form. I've heard of many, many stories of missionaries who've gone into villages thinking, you know, this is like new territory for them. And yet the people there in the village have had dreams of Jesus. You know, it's just incredible stories of him revealing himself to his people. And, you know, I firmly believe that God would make a way for those people to hear and to receive. But Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody can get to the Father but through me. So he disqualified all the other, like Muhammad, Buddha, all these other Hindu gods. You know, he said, I am the way. I am the only way to heaven. So we can't trust in just a higher power and repent. Because Muhammad didn't die for our sins, and he wasn't resurrected from the dead. You know, he didn't pay for our debt.
I was actually about to say Allah is a bad example, but do you believe that Muslims, Jews, and Christians all believe in the same God?
No.
Do you think
there may be similarities?
Well, do you think the Jews believe in the same God as Christians?
No, because they deny Christ, and Christ is a part of the Godhead. So in denying him, they're denying God. They have a form of godliness. They attempt to live holy lives, but without Christ, they can't enter into the kingdom of God. You know, that is the way that God made.
This, like, for like, I'm talking about just believing in that one God. Do you think it's this? They may have different views towards Jesus Christ and what God has done, but do you think it's the same entity?
They're believing in a false God. Just like I was explaining earlier, where these people, they've created a God to suit their own liking. Okay? They don't like the God that says...
So you're saying it's a different translation of what God is what you're trying to say. Like, they're looking at...
They're saying,
God,
I don't...
But they're looking at God, but they're not really listening to him. They're making their own...
Right. Like, they've created their own God. You know, they say, I don't want a God that's going to judge me and tell me that I can't have sex with my boyfriend. So instead, well, my God forgives my sin. This God doesn't even exist. My God forgives my sin. He overlooks my sin, and he doesn't care if I sin. I can do whatever I want. Well, that God doesn't exist. That's a false God. There's only one true God. And he's revealed himself to all of mankind through, I mean, and if you live in America, you can get a Bible anywhere. You know, we have a church on every corner. You know, they probably have them in the library here.
Sold book in the world.
Exactly.
What is it?
6 billion copies have been sold.
What's that one list of books, the most popular books? I forgot what it was. Like the New York Times bestseller?
Okay, I don't know.
Well, do you know the Bible has been taken off of all the book bestsellers?
Wow.
They had to take it off of the list because it kept getting number one over and over and
over.
Wow. So if someone brings up, if the Bible sold so much, why is it not in any of those lists? That's actually why.
Wow. Oh, I didn't know that. Off. That's awesome. But, you know, I would just encourage you, you know, to humble yourself and come to God with a broken and contrite heart over your own personal sin, you know, because we all need a Savior. We've sinned, we violated his law, and the only way to have our slate clean, the only way to be made right with him is trusting in his Son and turning from our sin. And, you know, if you haven't done that, you know, when you stand before God, you will be hellbound by your own choosing. God doesn't want you to perish. He desires it all, you know, come to him and trust in him and delight in him. But many will not, you know, but it's your choice.
I'm just wondering, it may be a little off topic. What do you view about Israel?
I believe that, you know, they were his chosen people. And but today, we are his people. The Christian believer is his chosen people.
So would you believe in, should the United States...
I think we should...
A predominantly Christian nation support Israel, a predominantly Jewish nation, even though they're going against
religion. God has a heart for Israel, but his people are those who have repented and trusted in him. So if the Jews in Israel are denying Christ, they're not his children, okay? But that was, you know, he had chose them in biblical times to be his people, and... In the end of times, it says that he will save a number of them, that he will take the veil from their eyes. And so I think we should be blessing Israel from, you know, the United States. We should be blessing Israel financially. We should be protecting them because, you know, there's a lot of historical significance and relationship that God had with them that we need. It's a sacred thing. It's a holy thing.
It's a sacred thing to all of them is the issue. And we can't just all...
Well, yeah, a lot of people think that that's their holy place, you know.
That's what I was getting to. A lot of them believe in the image of the Christian or Judaic God. It's like they all come from that sort of like stem, whether or not they're the true God or not.
Well, Jews, they accept like much of the Old Testament, but they deny that there's any truth to the New Testament, you know.
Why do you think that is?
Well, it's because that started the Gospels. That's where Jesus entered the picture.
What exactly is the Gospel exactly?
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It's 4 books out of the 66 of the Bible, and it's just a story of Christ's life on earth.
So those are the Gospels where Jesus is?
Yes.
Okay, I've always heard of it, but I never knew like if the book of Gospels.
Yeah, it's the same 4 accounts, but it's given from different perspectives, from different disciples. So, you know, like one was a doctor, one was a fisherman. So you have different perspectives, you know, like one is very intellectual in how he reports what happens. One may be very scientific in how he reports what happens. So you have like different variations, but it's the same events that happen. So you can like read them side by side. And, you know, it's kind of like if there was a bomb that exploded on campus and I was standing here and it happened over there and there was some, I could see, all I could see was like the smoke rising. You know, and
we
I
have a very different experience.
Yeah, than someone who is closer. So, but you know, the scriptures were written within a generation of Jesus' death. So a lot of people say, well, there's this great expanse of time, and how can we believe that it was true? But there were people willing to die for their faith. You know, they were martyred for what was in those scriptures.
Do you believe that you can't add anything new to the Bible?
Right. Right. Yeah.
So at all?
Well, like, what do you mean by that? Give me an example.
I'm not good with names. What was the one that defied Christ?
Christ?
Yeah, with the Judas. They uncovered a book of Judas. If they could have proven that it was written by him, it's like they sort of like uncovered it. It was like a sign. It was like a historical thing. If they could prove 100% that it was written by him, should that go in the Bible, or should that be like another asterisk? People should look at.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely, like, there's four books that I want to read that were included in the original canon, but I still want to read them because, you know, there's a lot of things in there.
There's a lot of historical. A lot of things the Bible doesn't talk about. I was just wondering if you think that those...
I wouldn't see them as scripture, holy scripture.
You wouldn't see them
as scripture. But I would definitely, you know, I mean, I want to read them. The Book of Enoch is one of them I want to read. I've been looking in the libraries for them, actually.
Well, I know... What happened was during the time of Rome, when Jesus was big, the main churches, they would only tell the big events, and they would keep retelling the stories like Noah's Ark, the story of Jesus giving, like putting the mud on the guy's eye and giving him sight.
Right, and that's how these stories were related back then when they, you know, were able to.
And that's what got into the New Testament, is those popular ones, but a lot of the more unpopular ones, the unheard ones, never got into the Bible.
Well, back then they had to memorize, and the Pharisees, religious leaders of the day, they had the whole Bible memorized, the Old Testament, the law, you know, the prophets, they had it all memorized. So it wasn't a matter of like telling, it's not like we tell a story today, like, hey, I went to the cafeteria and da 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 da.
I'm just saying that there's many stories that went untold or not as popular and didn't get into it. Because like the Bible had, it had to be approved by everyone.
Right.
You know
it said,
I mean?
Jesus said that, you know, that, well, I'm sorry, not Jesus. One of the disciples said that all the books in the world couldn't contain all the things that Jesus had done. You know, so there was, lots of things that happened that never made it into the Bible. But as far as like, if we say women should have the ability to choose abortion, okay, that should be amended into the Bible. No, because...
Well, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying like the stories you believe that... Those stories happen, but they're not holy.
I would say I would say there's historical truths that they probably, line up with what scripture says, but there was a reason they weren't included.
Okay.
And I'm not an expert, you know, a canonical expert. I'm sure that the Council of Dort and the men, the godly men that decided, you know, who was. Which books should be included into the Holy Canon that they had studied on their Greek and their Hebrew and the Aramaic, and they knew the original manuscripts, and based on the evidence, and just like God can do all these miraculous things, I know he could keep his word together intact. So I have no doubt that, you know, what's in there is exactly what God wanted to be in here. And you know, it's so cool that the God of the universe would give us something from him specifically. You know, like, this is me to you. This is like my love letter to you. You know, he didn't have to, but he chose to. It's like if I found out I was dying and I was pregnant, I would like want to do something so my child would remember me, like make a video or write him or her letters so that when they grew up, they would know a piece of their mother, who their mother was. You know, I would think of creative ways so that they would remember me. And I think it's ingenious what God did. You know, he used men as a tool to write down his word so that we would know how to live, so that we didn't have to go around wondering and questioning how to to live a pure and holy life, that we had instruction. We have an instruction manual, you know. But there's a lot of things I don't know, you know, a lot of things I don't know that I'm still studying, you know. Yeah, so I have a lot of free time, so I'm able to study and to draw closer to the Lord. But I'll never know completely or fully. It says, well, we only see as dim, like looking through a glass. So, but I know this is truth. And I know the one who knows everything, and I trust him.
So you said you're a fundamentalist.
I guess you could say that.
Well,
yeah.
But you believe that everything in the Bible happened is true, and you believe like that's sort of core belief.
I believe it's the inerrant word of God.
What do you believe about other, like, how do you feel about other denominations, like Lutherans or Mormons?
Mormons, to me, is a bad example. I believe it's a cult. But yeah. Other denominations, you know, it's sad because God wants us to be unified in Christ, in Him. But obviously, we have different understandings of His Word. And just like I was telling you earlier about critical thinking, where we've come to different conclusions and things like that, based on our studies, you know, that's what's caused these divisions and these splits. And I think they're somewhat necessary. I mean, even when Paul was writing parts of Scripture, there were divisions then, and there were false preachers then who were saying things contrary to Scripture and getting people to believe other things. So,
how do you feel about, like, who do you feel is the biggest impact on Christianity, besides for Jesus and God, of course? Like,
what do you mean the biggest impact?
Like the biggest, like Martin Luther went around spreading it from it, or
so like a figurehead.
Yeah, like, who do you think is the most important besides for Jesus Christ?
Oh gosh, I don't know. Probably Paul. You know, he was a persecutor of the Christians. He said that he was the chief of all sinners, and he shows like that no matter how hopeless you are, and no matter how bad you think you are, no matter how many sins you've committed, there's hope. You know, so I would say probably next to Christ, you know, Paul was a great redemption story of how you can be changed in Christ. But we're all a work of art. You know, all of us have been created uniquely and individually for the purpose of bringing God glory. So, and when we do that, it's a beautiful thing. And it does. It impacts Christianity greatly. So.
So much to like understand.
Yeah. And I'm glad you're seeking. You know, so many people just, they don't care to know. They don't care to think about these things, to ponder these things. But
I mean, honestly, even if you don't want to believe in God, no matter what, you should always understand why other people do. You should look at other people's, like, if you just keep your one, if you just keep your mind close to everyone's idea, it's not good.
But once you find the truth, you know, there is, like if someone came to me and said, Allah is God, you know, Allah is Lord. Like from the report that I heard yesterday from the school in Oregon, and I wasn't there, so I don't know. I heard that the shooter walked in, told them all to hit the ground, and those that were Christians to stand up. The ones that stood up, he shot and he killed. I don't know if that was true or not, but they were willing to die for what they believed to be true. And no matter, regardless of what anybody else told them, they knew that Jesus was Lord and that they would be with him. And nobody could take that truth away. Nobody. So when you have the knowledge of the truth, you don't have to be open necessarily to lies. You know, my mom taught me to look both ways before crossing the street. Now, I may have a friend next to me who says, well, my mom taught me not to look both ways before crossing the street, so I'm just going to walk out in traffic. So I may consider that perspective and think about it, but then think, well, that's not smart. That's not wise. And think about it intellectually and say, okay, if I do that, then I'm going to get hit by a car. So I'm going to choose to disregard.
But you're still going to listen.
That perspective. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't mind, you know, discussing these things and talking, obviously, yeah. You know.
It's important to talk about, even if you don't agree, if you have to hear other people's. And if anything, it makes your own beliefs stronger.
Yeah,
you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
It's the annoying thing when people do like creationists versus evolutionists. I think there's a place for science and religion, honestly.
Well, I don't think the two are mutually exclusive.
Well, I'm not, when I was a Christian, I wasn't as fundamentalist. I didn't believe the earth was created in 6 days. I believe that period of time was a great period of time. That's what I was taught. And I always viewed it as, science is just God's way of, it's how we did it. Why would, like, because it doesn't say God doesn't go up to people and just put a tree right there. He doesn't plant trees.
Right, right.
But something happens. He causes something to happen. That's how it's always
He created spiritual laws, and he also created natural laws.
I mean, that's how I view it. It's like God created it to be this way, so he doesn't have to do everything himself. He could create a functioning organization within itself. Which is sort of like why I don't know. I feel like we don't really need any central idea, ideology surrounding our daily lives, but people should be able to search for their own ideology. You know what I mean?
But if it leads them to hell,
it's the risk that they have to take. And if you truly believe in God, they're going to find their way.
Well, people are going to choose to go their own way too. I mean, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink, right?
Exactly. So. But you know, even if you go and tell someone, it's going to be the same way.
Even if you what?
Like, even if you're out here, you're just doing the exact same thing. You're just leading people to water.
Right, right. It's up to them ultimately to decide.
Which is why
I can strongly encourage, I can persuade, I can try to convince. But at the end of the day, they have to make their decision. Do I choose to follow Christ or do I not? Do I reject what she's saying or do I accept it? You know, am I going to implement these things in my life and apply them? Am I going to go read God's word and search for myself to see if what he says is true? Or am I just going to continue about doing what I was doing before I ever met her without even, you know, considering any of it? So, you know, you have that opportunity today. You know, I believe God crossed our paths for a reason. And like I said, when I was young, I purported that I knew God. I went to church, I prayed, I read my Bible, but I didn't have a right relationship with God. I professed that I did. I professed to know God, but my heart was far from him because I was refusing to repent. But now I have fellowship with him. I commune with him. I feel his protection on me. I don't fear man. You know, before I was in speech class in college, and I don't know if it was a panic attack, but I had such a hard time getting up in front of a class and talking to people about things that were insignificant and stupid. Things that are temporary. But now today I get up and talk about confrontational issues with people, even though I don't have a lot of knowledge or understanding. But I'm like, God, just use me. Help me to be a willing vessel. You know, I don't know everything there is to know, and there's a lot of people out there that are way smarter than me, but I'm willing to face rejection, and because I know I have the truth. I know it. And it doesn't matter if they're smarter than me. I know that I have the truth. And my heart is for others to come to know Christ in the way that I do, to be intimate with him, to have everlasting life. You know, I don't want them to perish. I care for their souls. It's not just about abortion. You know, this is a symptom of not having a right relationship with Christ, ultimately. There's a lot of symptoms like this, you know. This is one of the symptoms when we choose to rebel, but ultimately, our relationship with him is the most important thing. And if we don't have that right, if that's not right, everything is messed up in our lives, you know. Everything is off kilter, off balance.
So I'm just wondering, where in the Bible does it say the earth is like 6,000 years old? Is that sort of just like keeping a track record of all the
like events, the genealogy of, the, like, because it gives very specifically like a timetable or a...
So this is something you have to like search for, really. To like
in Matthew, I think it's at the beginning of Matthew. It gives the genealogy of Christ. So from all the way back from Adam.
Oh, okay.
And in the Bible, it says how many years each person lived.
Okay.
And so you can kind of trace that way. And so with the flood, Noah, the oldest person that ever survived was like 969 years old.
Like
so
Adam,
he
right?
knew like his, no, it wasn't Adam. It was,
I know he lived for a long time.
Yeah, it was the oldest one, he was 969 and he lived around the time of the flood. So he was able to share with his great, 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 great grandchildren what happened then. So it wasn't just like hearsay. You know, these were like stories passed down from generation to generation.
Really that old?
Yes, I do.
Why do you think people don't live that long?
There's scientific evidence to prove that, like the oxygen content in the world, and people were healthier then, and we didn't have so many defects in our genetic makeup and all kinds of things. They even have fossils of like cockroaches that were like 15 times the size that we have today.
Yeah, they don't have to do with the oxygen content, CO2 being lower. But I mean, it just seems like really
far-fetched.
A hard idea. Well, it's a hard idea to like wrap your mind around. Right. I don't believe it's far-fetched. I believe one day we'll actually get to that point again. Because like, look at the way technology is working. They said that the first person who lived to 150 years that we have recorded data of like now has already been born. They truly believe that now.
Yeah, I mean, with technology and stuff, but we have a lot of artificial enhancements, I think. Is it a good quality of life? I don't know, but...
Yeah, I honestly don't want to live to that long. That's sort of like, I don't know if I don't want to believe in heaven, or I'm sort of scared of it, that idea of...
Well, be more scared of hell.
Well, it's just scared of the afterlife.
Yeah.
I don't want to live forever.
The fear of the unknown.
I personally want to die and just go to nothing, because...
Then there's no consequence.
Well, not because there's no consequence, but because, you know, I couldn't imagine doing something. I'd get bored really easily.
Well, and it just seems it's not like we have this. There's no sin in heaven, so it's not like, why do we get bored? Because we're selfish and we want to be entertained.
Well, it'd be like whiplash too, you know what I mean? Going from a vastly different lifestyle.
Well, God, I think he's going to give us a completely different body and mind and soul, and we're going to be so intimate with him that nothing else is going to matter, and there won't be any boredom in heaven. There won't be any fears, there won't be any sorrow, there won't be any remorse, there won't be any sin. So it's going to be a beautiful thing. So anyways, I know I've taken up a lot of your time, but tell me your name again.
Chris.
I'm Deanna.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you for coming over. And
no problem.
Feel free to jump in now. He's probably got a little less of a crowd if you wanted to ask him something else.
No, it's fine. I gotta go to class now.
Okay.
I was just like hoping to get like a one-on-one conversation.
Yeah,
Actually,
it was really nice to talk with you.
Actually hear like an intelligent conversation instead of just fact bantering. After fact with no context. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, you can keep spitting facts about biology and when life begins, but there's a morality aspect we need to look at too.
Right. I agree
and
completely.
We have to look at it not just as the baby, not just as a mother. We need to find like a middle ground. We got to find an option for everyone. But you know, one day it'll eventually happen.
Thank you, Chris. Yeah, nice. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Nice meeting you.